Production and distribution of City Club Forums on IdeaStream are made possible by the generous support of PNC and the Raskin Family Fund, with additional funding from Cleveland State University, Robert Conrad, and the Payne Fund.
Good afternoon and welcome to the City Club of Cleveland. I'm Bob Littman, president of the City Club's Board of Directors and a proud member. It is my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Amos and Guiora. Dr. Guiora is the author of the book, The Crime of Complicity, The Bystander in the Holocaust, in which he examines the bystander effect through the lens of his personal family's personal Holocaust story. 6 million Jews were killed during the Holocaust, the deadliest genocide in our history. Since the mid-1940s, never again has been a global rallying cry whenever human rights are under threat. Throughout the American genocide, the Rwandan genocide, and various other authoritarian regimes, communities have fought the bystander effect by hearkening back to the Holocaust and the atrocities that the world watched happen. Today, for many of us, it probably seems unthinkable that the world would allow another attempt at a mass execution of a particular race or an ethnicity. And yet, survivors of the Holocaust have likened the nearly 470,000 people that have died in the Syrian Civil War to the apathy seen in the Holocaust. Dr. Guiora is here to share his thoughts on how we can continue to fight the bystander effect in contemporary society. In addition to being an author, Dr. Guiora is a professor of law at the S.J. Quinney College of Law at the University of Utah, where he teaches courses on national security, counterterrorism, and international relations. He has been deeply involved in negotiation efforts regarding the Israeli-Palestinian conflict and has testified before the U.S. Senate Judiciary Committee, the U.S. House of Representatives Committee on Homeland Security, and the Committee on Foreign Affairs in the Dutch House of Representatives. A retired lieutenant colonel in the Israeli Defense Forces, Dr. Guiora is actively involved in the effort to legislate Holocaust genocide education in Utah public schools. He is also the author of several previous books, including Freedom from Religion, Rights and National Security, and Tolerating Intolerance, and the Price of Protecting Extremism. Dr. Guiora also has ties to Northeast Ohio. He obtained his undergraduate degree from Kenyon College, and he's a graduate of Case Western Reserve's Law School. Ladies and gentlemen, members of the City Club, please welcome Dr. Amos Guiora.
Good afternoon. So in 30 minutes, I'm going to discuss with you the role of the bystander, both in the Holocaust and in sexual assaults today in the United States of America. The only way we can have this conversation, one preface, and that is that we speak as adults, because otherwise it is impossible to discuss the question of the bystander. I have written, as you correctly mentioned, a number of books on various topics. I've never thought about writing about the Holocaust, even though both of my parents are Holocaust survivors. I grew up in a home where the Holocaust was never mentioned, and I grew up in a home where I knew nothing about my parents' experiences, with one exception. When I was 12 years old, I grew up in Ann Arbor. When I was 12 years old, my father took me canoeing and said to me, in 1 minute, I'm going to tell you his story, and in 1 minute, I'm going to tell you your mother's story. And this is the first and last time you and I will ever have this discussion. I'm an only child. I come home, and the only person I can talk to is the family dog. So it's a monologue and not much of a dialogue. And I honored my parents' request that we never discuss the Holocaust or their experiences. When I went to Kenyon College, I had a mentor who was not Jewish, who said to me at some point, you know, at some point you really do need to confront this thing called your Judaism and the Holocaust. And I said, well, how do I go about doing this? And he suggested I write my senior honors thesis on the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising, which I did. And it was embarrassing, and I say this comfortably, because it's the truth, I really knew nothing about the Holocaust. Fast forward, we have three kids, we live in Israel, and when our first child was born, I said to my father, I need to add in parentheses, my father was a very distinguished academic with an extraordinary writing ability. So when our first kid was born, I said to my father, okay, so the hell with me, but you need to write your Holocaust story for your grandchildren, right? It's pretty important. So I get this, you know, two paragraphs thing. And I returned to him, I said, that's an F. I get a second draft, you know, three paragraphs, D, and I returned to him, I said, okay, so this isn't going to work. So that was it. For his 80th birthday, which is 12 years ago, I flew my parents in because Michigan was playing the team in Columbus, something, right? So I flew them in, and I said to my parents, the time has come at least to tape you about your experiences. And so a friend of mine who I've known for years who tapes Holocaust survivors taped my parents. But there's one condition, unfortunately, that I can't watch the video until both of my parents are dead. Right? 14 years ago, the Hungarian Catholic Church, for reasons that are not clear to me, but it's not important, decided to do a major conference in which they confronted their role in the Holocaust. And the role of the Hungarian Catholic Church is as bad can be bad. And they organized this 2-3-day conference, and they looked for a keynote speaker, and they had two conditions. One, that it'd be a Hungarian Holocaust survivor, and two, that it'd be someone who's a world-class academic. Long story short, they invited my father. So he and my mother went. I knew nothing about this. My mother did not go hear the talk. The following year, they did another conference. They invited him again. I said to my father, this time I'm coming with you. So I went. I don't speak any Hungarian. The only thing I understood was when he said CNN. But other than that, I have no idea what he said. And that was it. Fast forward. I ran a marathon. Have any of you ever run a marathon? Okay, so when you run it, well, you obviously have, right, with your fabulous time in Boston. But when you run a marathon, what do you have to do? But you kill time, right? It's a mile after mile. So I had a running partner when I was training for the Salt Lake City Marathon, who's not Jewish. So when you run a marathon, you're training and training, right? And training and training. Out of nowhere, one day she says to me, because we're killing time and killing miles, she says to me, how did all this happen? Right? The Holocaust. And that's how the book was born. And I turned to her and I said, I don't know. So I became, if you will, autodidactic on the Holocaust. But one thing and one thing only became my obsession. I know obsession is not a polite word, but that's okay. It's the role of the bystander. The perpetrator, whether it's Eichmann or Himmler or Heydrich, Hitler, all those other people are of no interest to me. Enough has been written about them. Yes, they're all evil and they're awful and they're horrible. They are of no interest to me. What is of interest to me, the polite word in academia is of interest, the impolite word is obsession, is the bystander, the one individual who sees another individual in distress and then has a decision to make. Will I be involved? Will I provide assistance? Or will I turn my back? Will I do this? So in beginning the process of understanding the role of the bystander in the Holocaust, I undertook a very detailed study, lack of a better word, about my parents' experiences in the Holocaust. And anybody who's ever done anything like this knows you really are confronting evil. There's no other word. So when I decided to write the book, I asked my mother, who lives in Jerusalem, what are her thoughts about my writing this book, and she was very much opposed to it for the very reasons that she knew this would result in uncovering some, you know, dark stuff. And it took her a while to come on board, and at the end of the day, she said, fine. My family, my wife and kids were also very hesitant about it for a reason I'll explain in a second. Then I decided, to hell with it. I'm going to write this thing. Because I want to understand, how is it that as a 12-year-old child, my mother was taken to be shot and nobody said a word? And how is it my father's on a death march and nobody says a word? And that for me became, again, obsession. So I was very, very fortunate that foundations and private donors, the University of Utah, were very generous in making significant funds available to me, which enabled me over the course of the past 5 years to travel to Europe a lot and to begin the process of interviewing people. Because I wanted to interview the following types of people. I wanted to interview Holocaust survivors, which is in a sense like talking to my mom. But I also wanted to talk to Holocaust experts, Jewish and Gentile alike. And I wanted to talk to children of Gentile bystanders. So when you undertake this, you begin the process of putting together a network, of reaching out to people who reach out to people, you know, person A, person B, person C, a network. And I want to share with you a number of different stories in order to have you understand the bystander. So my mother is the Aunt Frank of Hungary. She's 12 years old, like Aunt Frank was 12 years old in the Netherlands. My mother is in hiding with her mother in the upstairs attic. They live in a building with four, with a courtyard in the middle. They live upstairs. They're fed every day by an elderly Catholic woman who, unfortunately, we don't remember her name, because if we did remember her name, if my mother remembered her name, we would name her, you know, a righteous Gentile, but she doesn't remember. So she's in hiding. The Nazis come in March of 1944, and they go right away into hiding. My grandfather is sent to a work camp in the Ukraine. My mother, like me, is an only child. Inevitably comes the knock on the door, right, to come downstairs to the courtyard to be shot. They are in the courtyard to be shot when my grandmother says to my mother, when the shooting starts, fall, and I will fall on top of you. At the last moment, there was a group called Young Pioneers, who were Jews who had stolen uniforms of the Arrow Cross. The Arrow Cross were the Hungarian collaborators with the Nazis. And the Jews who had stolen the uniforms of the Arrow Cross at nights would frantically go around Budapest neighborhoods trying to save Jews from being shot at the last moment. And this particular night, for reasons known but to whomever, the Jews wearing Arrow Cross uniforms showed up, told the real Arrow Cross, leave these Jews to us, and then my mother and my grandmother were saved. They go running through the streets of Budapest. And here's what my mother remembers. As they're going through the streets of Budapest, clearly identified because they're wearing the yellow star, not a word from anybody. Not one word from anybody who clearly sees a mother and child in clear distress. My mother was taken to be shot a second time. The details I don't know, because my mother won't share the details of the second time with us. Okay. But what's important for us is as they're running, people see them, and nobody says a word. That's the classic bystander. Right? My father was 19 years old in the Jewish Theological Seminary in Budapest, in March of 44, when the bad guys come. And this is as perverse can be. The Nazis turned the Jewish Theological Seminary into their headquarters. Why? Because that's the way we did things. They come in March of 44. In June of 1944, there's a call-up for Jews of certain age, certain birth dates, certain names, whatever, to report to a train station, always a train station, to be taken to Bor. Bor was a mining camp, labor camp in Serbia. My father is transported from Budapest to Bor. This is June 1944. Irony of ironies, he's transported on his birthday. Okay. He's there until November of 44. Anybody who's been to Serbia, I know. The winters are the cold is cold and the winter is the winter. That's right. There are 6,000 to 8,000 Jews in this work camp in November of 44 when they make the decision, the bad guys make the decision to close the camp. Why close the camp in November of 44? Because the Russian army, the Red Army, is coming in from the east. The bad guys want to get out of town, so they close the closing of Auschwitz in January of 45. Okay. So my father's camp is closed in November of 44. There are between 6,000 to 8,000 Jews in this camp. The number is unclear because, you know, the number is unclear. They divide the Jews into two different groups. It's either 3,000 and 4,000, all right, okay. The first group, if I had a map, they come from Bor down, and then they make a right towards going back to Hungary. Whether it's 3,000 or 4,000, who knows, all are murdered. They're all ambushed at the Hungarian border. The second group is what, you know, there goes there, for the grace of God go I. My father's in the second group. Why? Because in those 4 days between the first group and the second group, an ambush was put together by Tito's partisans, right? So they come down to this town, and there Tito's partisans kill some of the guards, unfortunately not all of the guards. And I say that very clearly and deliberately. Now we have panic. We have between 3,000 to 4,000 people in the middle of the night. Where do I go? What do I do? In terms of the physicality of it, my father has one shirt, one pair of pants, shoes, yes, no compass, no GPS, no Instagram, no anything. And what do you do now? Full stop. Go back to when I was 12 years old. When I was canoeing, that 1 minute that he gave me the Holocaust spiel, he told me about the liberation, and then he told me the following. And then out of nowhere appeared a Russian jeep that took me to Sofia, Bulgaria. Okay, so when you're 12 years old, right, you believe the things you're told, and I believe that story. It's a lovely story. It's not true. Here's what happened. At that moment of sheer panic, there's no other way to put it, my father led a group, it's either of three or four people, from this town in Serbia, through the mountains, 136 kilometers, to Sofia in Bulgaria. I need to add that I'd always viewed my father as he couldn't make his way from where you're sitting to the front door without my mother helping him. It turns out that's not true. In parentheses, within parentheses, growing up as a kid in Ann Arbor, I said to my dad, listen, everybody's father plays golf, plays tennis, jogs. You're the only one who doesn't do a damn thing. And he looked at me, my father never, ever, ever raised his voice at me, looked at me and said, I survived the Holocaust. Don't you think that's enough? And I never understood what he meant until this story. So he goes 136 kilometers through the mountains, village to village to village to village. The bystander. Not one bystander, not one villager offered him assistance. Now, we also have to understand the circumstances. In November 1944 in Serbia, who knows who is on whose side? They're also walking at night because they're afraid of walking in the day because they don't know if the Russian soldiers are here and the German soldiers are there and what the villager will do. So it's nighttime, nighttime, nighttime. While I was writing the book, my father unfortunately fell. Head met sidewalk, sidewalk one. So he became cognitively very impaired, and for 4 years he was slowly dying. And I said to myself, I've got to finish this book before he dies. Unfortunately, I didn't. But for 3 days out of nowhere, while he was slowly dying, all the wires recrossed. And I was able to interview him for the first time in my life about the Holocaust. And it's in the book. I mean, literally word for word. He did not agree to be videotaped. He didn't want to be photographed. Didn't want me to record him. I think he was concerned about how he looked, which I didn't understand because I thought he looked great. So I just, you know, do we use the word type? You guys know what a typewriter is? Yeah, we type. Okay, fine. And here was the bystander. If I had a glass in my hand, villager after villager, taunting them with water. Boom, 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 boom. What's interesting is both my parents utterly and totally disagree with my premise, which is that the bystander owes the victim a duty. And the reason that they both disagree with me, and disagreement is fine and healthy, is because from the perspective of either it's the Serbian villager or the Hungarian Gentile, the Jew is the other. And the other is not owed a duty. And I'm going to digress for 30 seconds. I hope I'm not offending anybody's politics, but I have to put this in there. And I apologize in advance. I think it was 2 weeks ago when the press secretary of the President of the United States of America, and I won't get into politics, with one exception, said that Germany did not kill its own population. For those of us who are students of the Holocaust, that's the old canard that Jews really weren't Germans. That is we have to be polite. That's a devastating argument. It's outrageous. What's interesting is, when my father was very clear about this, that he as the Jew was the other and the duty was not owed to him, I understand the argument, but respectfully, I very much disagree with that. Right. So I've taken you to the courtyard where my mother was to be shot, and I have to take you to two or three other places. First place. I write a book about the Netherlands because I spent a lot of time in the Netherlands. I have a PhD from the Netherlands, and I have lots of connections in the Netherlands. And last year, I went to Maastricht. Maastricht is a town in southern Holland where there had been a sizable Jewish community all wiped out. And in Maastricht, I had the following conversation. But I told you at the very beginning of this conversation that we're having now, the only way we can have this is if we're all adults, because the conversation I'm going to share with you is a terrible conversation. I was told that there's an 85-year-old woman, my mother's age, who's Gentile, who's willing to meet with me. Because she wants to talk to me about her father, who was Gentile. She lived in what is called the Jewish Street. It was called the Jewish Street because it was predominantly Jewish, not exclusively, because they were Gentiles. I go to her house, knock on the door. I've been told I have 20 minutes. Parentheses within parentheses. When you write a book like this and you interview people, they are extremely time sensitive, and people are very, very much limit you to how much time they're willing to give you because these conversations are awful. Okay. I knock on the door, and the woman who opens it is obviously not 85 years old. She's a much younger woman, and it was clear that she was the translator. I also need to add that translation is a real issue in these kinds of conversations. Okay. So I come into this woman's house. She's 85. I'm told 20 minutes. Exactly, and I'm told at the end of 20 minutes, she'll ask you to leave. Okay. She says to me, you know, Professor, in Holland, there's a tradition that if we invite you to our home, we have to offer you tea. And I thought, well, you know, how long is it going to take her to make? So it takes her a while to make tea, and I got like 12 minutes left. Okay. And then she says, you know, Professor, there is a tradition in the Netherlands that if we offer you tea, we also have to offer you a biscuit. Okay, now we've got 8 minutes left. And I'm really serious about this. We sit and she starts telling me her story about what was to be the Jewish street and the neighbors, and then we get to the heart of it. That in the day of deportation of the Maastricht Jews, she was told by her father to go across the street and to say goodbye to, unclear exactly in Dutch, from the two classmates who lived across the street. She tells me she wasn't exactly sure what it meant to say, you know, but she had a premonition that bad things were going to happen. She goes across the street. She says goodbye. Whatever exactly, when you're 12, what does that mean? It's unclear, right? She comes back. Her father's waiting for her. They look out and they see the mother and the two children walking. Then they make a left turn where the truck is waiting to take them to the train station and then obviously to Auschwitz. Then her father closes the curtains. But she looks out and she sees all this. And then we get to the hard part. She says to me, I know what you want to hear from me. And I said, I don't want to hear anything from you other than your story. By the way, we're way past 20 minutes now. We're like in 2 hours into this conversation. With more than one, it's becoming a very, very difficult and emotional conversation. She says to me the following. My entire life, my father has been my hero. My father raised 7 children by himself. My mother had died when I was a small child. My father took care of us, and my father is my hero, my father is my hero. I said, I understand that. Full stop. Until today. She said, I had never thought of my father as a bystander. She said, my father saw them going on the truck and not doing anything. At which point, she totally breaks down, as does the translator. And I said to her, I said, I had no intention to put any words in your mouth. That's not the purpose. She said, I'd never, ever connected A to B until you came into my house. Okay, so at which point she says to me, and I understood this totally, she said, I request that you leave now. And I, obviously, okay. So as I'm leaving, she says, come back. Okay. She takes me back into the kitchen. She says, please look up. On her kitchen, there's one picture, and only one picture. It's of the two classmates who were taken to Auschwitz. She's the only person in the world who has this picture. I looked at it. She said, please take a picture of it. I want you to have a picture of it, and now I really do want you to leave. And obviously, you know, I did. But it reinforces the really critical question. The core of the book, from my perspective, is who is the bystander, and what's the duty of the bystander? All right, last story before we get into contemporary society. I decided that I have to confront evil. I mean, evil is evil, and there are two places for me that are the manifestation of evil. One is Wannsee. Wannsee is the villa outside Berlin, 20 kilometers outside of Berlin, where the final solution was decided. Heydrich convenes a meeting. Eichmann is there. It's an absolutely beautiful villa on Lake Wannsee. It is truly beautiful. They sat for 1 hour and 20 minutes around the table and decided on the final solution, i.e. the murder of 6 million Jews. By the way, I have to put in parentheses for educational purposes. I'm asked all the time about, did my grandparents die in Auschwitz? No. My grandparents were murdered in Auschwitz. They didn't die in Auschwitz. There's a huge difference. That's where they sat for an hour and 20 minutes, and they decided on the murder of 6 million Jews. I read a lot about Wannsee. I read about the conference and who sat where in the magical table. Okay. Eichmann had written about it, that after the meeting, he was really pleased. How perverse, right? That Heydrich had invited him to have cognac and a cigar with him. Okay. So I said, I'm going to stand where they sat and had their cognac and cigar, you know, celebrating. I walked around, and I stood there, and I don't know how to explain this other than viscerally. I didn't know if I was going to collapse, vomit, and I said the best thing I can do is light up a cigar. And that was my victory cigar. And I mean that very seriously. But to be there and to understand that that is where the fate of my grandparents was sealed, and then you walk around Vons and you see the pictures, and here's the one thing you see in all those pictures. Thousands upon thousands upon thousands of bystanders. I need to, the cover of the book, the cover of the book is an extraordinary picture that was given to me for free by the Vanze Center of a picture of deportation with the bystander there. And that's their contribution to the book, for which I'm enormously thankful and grateful. The last place where I went to confront evil, I said, I have to go see where my father was raised. And what was important for me were three things. One, to go to the Jewish cemetery to see the names, my grandparents' names are inscribed in a memorial in the Jewish cemetery. I stood there, and those of you who are Jewish, I said the mourner's Kaddish, right? Then I hired a Hungarian genealogist. I said, I don't care how much this costs. Whoever you have to bribe, you bribe. I want to find my father's house. Most importantly, for the following reason. I want to retrace the walk of my grandparents from house to train station. So how do you do that? Well, you can't make this stuff up. When I was at the Jewish cemetery saying Kaddish for my grandparents, there was a woman there who's a little bit older than me, whose mother was my grandparents' neighbor 75 years ago. She comes back from Auschwitz. She's one of the four survivors from this godforsaken town who comes back from Auschwitz. She had shared with her daughter the deportation process. So the bystander. The walk from house to train station, which I did in car, and I took 1,000 pictures of the damn thing. Here's what I learned. The Hungarian Gentile neighbor, as he sees the Jew carrying, you know, schlepping the bags, spitting, swearing, and hitting the Jews. Not one offered assistance. That, for me, is a classic bystander. There's no excusing that conduct. So when we retraced it, I said, now I want to go stand on the platform from where they stood when they got on that train to take them to Auschwitz. That, for me, was the evil of the evil, the confronting of the confronting, and I made myself stand there. I took 1,000 pictures of it. And I don't know if any of you have ever been to Hungary. The train stations have been renovated. The platforms have not. They are still like they were back then, and the trains are like they were back then. And I'm standing there, I'm saying to the genealogist, I said, I'm done. You know, we're done. He says, wait 2 minutes, and here comes the train, and it literally takes you back. And in terms of the physicality, you understand the Jew, the train, and most importantly of all for me, the Hungarian bystander who watches all this. Right. Now let's move ahead. I am not a historian. I am not a sociologist. I am not a psychologist. What I am is a law professor who asks himself the following question. Is the bystander guilty of a crime? Is there here a crime of complicity? Is there a crime of non-intervention? And then the question becomes, how do you make this relevant to contemporary society? And I decided to make it relevant to contemporary society to address head-on the questions of sexual assaults on college campuses. I don't know how many of you follow this stuff, how many of you read about this stuff. Sexual assaults are a real problem today on college campuses. And again, I want to emphasize, the perpetrator for me is a bad guy. He needs to go away. But he's not the important person for me. It's the bystander who's there watching the damn thing. I'm going to share two stories with you, and I've already apologized twice. I won't apologize again. The first one happens at Vanderbilt University. His name is Vandenberg. He's a football player. He's, you know, big dude. He has an on-off girlfriend. They go out at night. She is totally drunk. He brings her back. This is all on camera. He brings her back to the dorm room. She's unconscious. She's on the floor. He texts the guys across the hallway saying, come on over. She's here. She's free. She's available. Do whatever the hell you want to do to her. His roommate, sleeping in the upstairs bunk, is another football player. His name is Mac Prelo. Vandenberg shakes Prelo and says, dude, come on, she's here, she's free, you know, she's easy, whatever the hell you want to do, you can do to her. Prelo, in his testimony, quote, I feigned sleep because it made me uncomfortable. He, at some point in the middle of the night, after she's been raped by the two guys across the hallway and sodomized by Vandenberg, He, Prelo, comes down from his upstairs bunk, sees her on the floor, opens the door. In whatever county Nashville, Tennessee is in, whatever county it is, the decision was made not to prosecute Prelo. Vandenberg goes to jail for life, which is where he needs to be. I mean, but he's not interesting to me. Prelo, I know it sounds odd, but I decided, what the hell, to follow him on Facebook. This is a guy who has zero remorse, zero understanding of what you want from him, because from his perspective, gosh, he was uncomfortable. Second story. A number of years ago, you may know the story, Avery, in Las Vegas with Cash and Strohmeyer. Cash and Strohmeyer are 19 years old, invited by Strohmeyer's father to go spend the weekend gambling in some casino in Vegas. Strohmeyer sees a 7-year-old girl named Charisse Iverson, grabs her, takes her into the bathroom. Cash follows them into the bathroom. Cash and Strohmeyer are best friends, are buds. Strohmeyer takes her into a stall, closes the door. Cash goes to the stall next to Strohmeyer, stands on the toilet seat, looks over the stall, and sees Strohmeyer raping her. Says to Strohmeyer, "Yo, dude, what are you doing?" Strohmeyer mumbles something, "Hey, you know, whatever it is, right?" Cash walks out of the bathroom. Waits for Strohmeyer outside the bathroom. When Strohmeyer comes out, Cash says, "Hey, what'd you do?" He says, "Raped her, strangled her, or killed her." In whatever county Las Vegas is in, the district attorney decides the following. Strohmeyer goes to jail for life, life imprisonment, not death, because he pled guilty. Fine. Cash, nothing. Because there's no bystander law in this county in Nevada. Cash goes to the University of California, Berkeley. His classes are boycotted. He's ostracized. He, by the way, has no idea what the hell you want from him. If you want to see a sociopath, go to watch this on YouTube. 60 Minutes, Ed Bradley interviews him. He says, "Hey, I didn't know her. I should really feel sorry. I mean, what do you want from me?" Okay. For me, Prelo and Cash are the manifestation of why there needs to be bystander legislation. These are two people who need to be in jail, or at least need to be fined, or need to have some criminal penalty imposed on them. So I'm told the following. The best defense is a good offense. Here's what's wrong with my theory. One, we will always know to do the right thing. No, we won't. And I don't mean this disrespectfully to any of you. Even if you've been bystanders in the past, even if you'll be bystanders in 5 minutes, you have no idea how you will act as a bystander. I've been a bystander an X number of occasions. Once I got it right, and on other occasions I screwed up and I didn't. And I think I'm a reasonable person. So you can't rely on you knowing to do the right thing. Two, the idea of imposing this obligation of you to save you is the state taking too much of a role on itself. That's all right, that's argument number two. And number three is you can't criminalize behavior. Okay. So my response to all that, maybe yes, maybe, I don't know, but here's the truth. If you think about Charisse Iverson being murdered and strangled in that damn bathroom with Cash doing this, and his failure to intervene on her behalf absolutely imposes the requirement to create a law that says the bystander is responsible, whether it's jail time or a fine or whatever the hell it may be. So in the book, I've drafted legislation, proposed legislation. I suggest a monetary fine. I mean, we can argue about that. I need to add, when I gave this talk at University of Virginia Law School in October, the students all raised their hand, unanimous. By the way, anybody who does law school, unanimity does not exist, right? Absolutely not, okay. They all agreed with me that what's his name, Prelo, fine is enough. They all told me the following. Cash needs to go to jail, because that's the only way to honor the memory of Charisse Iverson, which I just found to be a very interesting argument. So, as you mentioned, I'm now involved in bystander legislation in the state of Utah and Holocaust education, because I think there's a direct link between the bystander legislation and Holocaust legislation. Because here's what we need to ask ourselves, we as society, do we say, bad things happen, oh gosh, and somebody will know to do the right thing? Or do we say, wait a minute, we actually owe a duty to each other. Not a moral duty, but a legal duty. It's obviously complex, it's obviously controversial, and from my perspective as the one, who wrote the book, the best thing that I can hope for, and I'm incredibly grateful to you for this invitation, is to put this out there. and to have society at least ask the question, can we impose a legal duty to act? And if we fail to act, can we impose a penalty on you, whatever, however we define the penalty? Because I really believe, based on my parents' stories, experiences, I think about the sexual assaults today, the reliance on doing the right thing, it doesn't work. Yes, there will always be the person who will stand up and do the right thing, but as a norm, that's incorrect. And I finish with two stories. I don't know how many of you follow the Detroit news carefully. Last week in Detroit, a mother comes into, it's unclear if it's a pool or it's a lake, it wasn't exactly clear to me. She's holding her three-year-old child. She's in her 30s, and with her is a family friend who's also in his 30s. They come into the water, and kids being kids, you know, she loses control of their child. The child is now flailing and drowning in the water. And I stop here deliberately for a second. How did I really get into the bystander question? I got into it because when I was 5 years old, when we were living in Israel, I went swimming with my 14-year-old cousins. They were twins. One had cerebral palsy, the other did not. And the cousin and I, the one with cerebral palsy, whose name was Dunny, we were in the deep end, and we had an argument. You know how to swim, you don't know how to swim, you know how to swim, you don't know how to swim. I got out of the water. He drowned. And the book very deliberately opens with an account of the last minutes. And then when you turn the page, the first picture in the book is the last picture taken of him, taken by my mother the day before he died. So for me, the question of swimming in water is a real issue. That's why I'm finishing with this. So this three-year-old in Detroit is drowning, flailing in the water. Above the pool, there's a bridge. There are people standing there filming. Now, I apologize for the word. It strikes me as beyond perverse, give me a better word, to film a three-year-old child drowning. Is perverse a good word? Not one person dials 911. There's a gentleman standing watching all this who does not know how to swim. He is a parolee. He jumps into the water and saves the child. Unfortunately, he's not able to save the family friend who drowns and dies. I said to myself, this is perfect. Every one of those people standing in that bridge is a bystander. First of all, the thought of filming a drowning child, right? And in the proposal, I have one demand expectation of the bystander. It's really complicated. We all have cell phones. I mean, today children are born with cell phones, right? 911. That's it. All it requires is that boom, boom, boom. First responders, hello, police. There's a child drowning on 1234 Main Street. Come right away. That's all I expect. That's the only duty I propose imposing on the bystander. That's all I got. Thank you very much.
Today we are enjoying the forum with Dr. Amos Guiora, professor in the S.J. Quinney College of Law at the University of Utah, and author of The Crime of Complicity, The Bystander in the Holocaust. We are about to begin the audience Q&A. We welcome questions from everybody, City Club members, guests, students, and those that are joining us by way of webcast. If you'd like to tweet a question, please tweet it at the City Club, and our staff will try to work it into our program. We want to remind you that your questions should be brief and to the point. Holding the microphone today is content coordinator Teddy Eisenberg. To my left, may we have our first question, please?
We're actually going to take the first question from Twitter. Someone would like to know, how do we get the people who really need to hear what you have to say to listen?
Three really quick answers. One is extraordinary forums like this. Again, I'm incredibly grateful to all of you for making this possible. Two is, as anybody who writes a book, I'm not the only one in the room who's written a book, right? You never know if anybody other than your mother will read a book that you write. If the book serves as a discussion point, it serves as a discussion point. The internet today facilitates conversations. And if the book serves that purpose, then from my perspective, that's the best I could hope for. And I need to put out, and I need to be honest about this. Whether people agree with me or disagree with me, you know, I leave that up to them. For me, what's really important is to have the conversation. And to the question, public conversations, discussions, the more forums, the better. I mean, I'm very grateful to, you know, whether it's here in Cleveland or the other day in Chicago, next week in Albuquerque, then New York. I mean, I understand that the book makes noise, which is what you hope for. And if it leads to discussion, you know, as we say, Nieder sei gesund, that's the best you can hope for.
When you talked about your parents talking about that they were the other, so that, you know, the it didn't really apply, the bystander, do you think that then when we as a society or a segment of society, when we start pointing out whether it's Syrians or Muslims or Mexicans, is that going down the road of saying that some are the other?
I think that's a great question. I told you that my parents disagreed with me, right? The tagging of the other, by the way, that word is a terrible word, the other, whether it's African Americans, Jews, Muslims, I mean, whatever it is. It's a convenient re-articulation of, I don't owe them, they're not of me, they're not, you know, we don't share the same DNA. I want to get into the politics of the moment, but the tagging, if I may use that word, of particular ethnic groups, it clearly creates divisions within society. I mean, society is divisive enough as it is. But to create additional divisions clearly creates this sense of, I don't owe her a duty because she's not of me. And that's just something that's why I told you, I totally disagreed with my parents, right? Respectfully, lovingly, but I think they're wrong. I don't think there's any, if there's a person in distress, right? Whether it's him or her, a person in distress is a person in distress. And I really do believe that I owe her a duty, like she owes me a duty, regardless of the fact that she may be this and I may be that. That's, for me, not a relevant consideration. And I think the tagging of the other, I couldn't agree with you more. It sets up or resets, you know, that terrible paradigm that we went through 75 years ago. And obviously, you know, the Holocaust, you know, it's not the only Holocaust, whether you mentioned the Rwandan or the Armenian. It's the other. It's a terrible, terrible word. And that's something that I address in the book, that it creates these false divisions that are really dangerous.
Indulge me for just a second. I'm going to share a very brief story because this is really amazing that I heard you speak, and you'll understand in a second why. I was born and raised in what's now Serbia, the former Yugoslavia. You talked about Serbia, and you talked about bystanders. My grandfather in 1944 was a medical school student, finishing medical school, and he ended up secretly, and he's a genteel, non-Jewish person, Serbian person, he ended up secretly treating some Jewish people who were either on their way to war or on their way back, and I'm not exactly sure, you know, where, but in 1944, he ended up doing this, obviously, at the risk of his own life, because this is the Germans were still in power, and he ended up not talking about this for about 60 years, and I think the parallel to your parents not talking about the Holocaust, because this is obviously a very traumatic event for himself, but ultimately this came to light, and he actually was honored by the State of Israel. He got the Righteous Genteel Award that you talked about. So your story is really personally you know, incredibly touching to me. So my true question, though, is when you talk about this bystander duty, I'm sure you're aware that many European nations, Western democracies, actually have criminal legislation,
totally,
which criminalizes bystander conduct or this type of omission, and actually imposes a duty to act, not just to call 911,
but to act
if you, let's say, you are a lifeguard, you're a great swimmer, if there's a child drowning, you would actually have a duty to act. So I don't know if you talk about that in the book.
I do.
Yeah.
I think that you make a great point. By the way, I need to put out there, in terms of urban legend, right, when you write a book like this, you learn all kinds of things. For instance, there's bystander duty in Germany. An urban legend is that after 33, they changed the legislation to say there's not a duty to save Jews. Incorrect. So I very deliberately raised this. Urban legend says they changed the law. They didn't. There's been one case in Holland, a complicated case, where two bystanders were convicted, but in a really complicated case, and in Italy also, but there the facts are very complicated, but those are the only two cases I found in recent years in Holland and Italy where bystanders were indeed prosecuted and convicted.
I think that it's possible that many of us have been bystanders under certain situations.
Right.
I'd like to think not, but I think it's very possible. Mm-hmm. What I want to know is, through all of your research, have you been able to discern the difference between the bystander and the person who does take action? And what kind of studies have been done? I mean, we can have all kinds of laws, but in fact, why would I be a bystander and not a bystander? What makes the difference in who I am?
I think it's a great question. So I will relate to you three stories about myself as a bystander. One where I did the right thing, and two where I didn't. And I'm just like you. I'm like just a normal sort of guy. I was in Chicago 40 years ago with a college roommate. We were walking down Michigan Avenue, State Street, whatever that was. And I had a sandwich in my hand. And I had worked in an emergency room that's important to the story at the University of Michigan Hospital. And we're walking down the street. I got my sandwich in my hand. And there was a crowd gathered, you know, like in a huddle, looking at a woman who was having a horrible epileptic seizure. I mean, awful. You know, her head is banging up, and it was awful. And they're all, oh, my God, oh, my God. Okay. This is before the age of a cell phone. Some of you may have heard of something called a payphone. Okay. Nobody did a damn thing. But they were all, oh, my God. Okay. So I felt competent to offer her, you know, assistance. And then once I started acting, then people said, you know, let me give you a coat, a sweater, whatever. Okay. Cops, the ambulance shows up, the first responders, the cops. Oh, by the way, Chicago cops, I don't know how this works, they're all 6'5", 250 pounds, right? Says, who's the person who, you know, did the right thing here? And the crowd said, you know, pointed at me, yay for me. Okay, guy, you know, on behalf of the city of Chicago, congratulations. I went back to get my sandwich. Somebody taken my sandwich. So there I did the right thing. Two other instances. I'm going to a football game in Ann Arbor with Lentz. And we see a homeless guy, you know, with the bag. I mean, not with the bag, you know, the shopping cart filled with the beer cans, right? College student comes up to him and overturns his cart. We kept walking. That's a criminal act. I absolutely could have done something. They didn't even offer the homeless guy, yeah, I'm really sorry. Not a damn thing. And I'm just normal like anybody else. The second story, a number of years ago, we had neighbors across the street where we live in Israel. The child was crying and crying and crying and crying. The kid was about 8 or 10 years old. And at some point, I said to my wife in the middle of the night, like, something is obviously wrong, right? Yeah, okay, fine. Turned out that his parents had locked him out of the house deliberately. Why didn't we act? The only answer I can give you is a one word, because. Will I today impose a criminal penalty on myself? You bet. Why did I act in this instance, and why didn't I act in these instances? You know, I've spent more time interviewing psychologists on the bystander phenomenon. You know, the theory says that if there are lots of bystanders, nobody does anything. There's only one, the chances are increased. I interviewed a guy in Jerusalem who's considered one of the experts on the psychology of the bystander. I can be an honest reporter and say to you that there really is no clear explanation as to why one person acts and the other doesn't, nor why in one instance you, take me, I'm betting, you know, 33% in baseball that gets you in the Hall of Fame. In this instance, I failed two different people, and I have no rational explanation.
Thank you for coming today. My name is Tamison. I'm from Mayfield High School. Your speech was very educational, and you have a very interesting point of view. My question is, taking from your speech, you spoke about personal bystander bystand effect. What about nations that ignored the Holocaust during the World War II?
That is a great question that I struggled with a lot when I started writing the book. I asked myself, in addition to looking at your duty to me, will I look also at states? And will I look at institutions? And the obvious institution is the Catholic Church, right? And I decided that for me, in terms of how I want to structure the book and the question of complicity, I don't look at institutions and I don't look at governments. For me, the only relevant question is, did you act or did you not act? Others have written about the question about the role of the Catholic Church and the role of nation states. You know, President Roosevelt's failure to allow Jews, the great book, while 6 million died. I decided that to look at institutions would be, for me, in terms of this book, too much. I want to really focus on the individual, you to me. And I want to, maybe as a follow-up to your question, I've been asked repeatedly, if you turn on however you want to get your news, CNN, Fox, or whatever, and you see what's happening in Syria, are you a bystander? And I decided that for me, in terms of individual complicity, there has to be a relationship of physicality. The two of us here, what's happening 9,000 miles away, as awful as what's happening in Syria is, and it is, for me, in terms of how I define and see the criminal law, you are not responsible for failing to act on behalf of whatever's happening in Syria. That's unlike if you walk down Euclid Avenue after we finish today and somebody falls and you just keep on walking. For me, you then would be guilty of the crime of non-intervention.
I've read, and there's been a lot of studies about children of Holocaust survivors. And listening to you, your background, at least, seems the classic situation where the parents don't want to talk about it. You are, but you didn't come out as the classic, at least from what you said, as the product of the Holocaust survivors. What are your comments about that?
Well, that's a great, great question. Anybody who's been to Israel knows that what we say in Hebrew is that we live in the shadow of the Holocaust. And the twist on that is BS, we live in the Holocaust, right? I have friends who are like me, second generation, whose entire dinner table conversations revolved around the Holocaust. I don't know how it would be in English. Are they more Shoati? Are they more Holocaustized than I am? I don't know. I will tell you this, that you write a book. It took me 4 years to write this book. Most books take me about a year. This took me 4 years. And I came to, I think this answers your question. I came to the realization that there are two things, in addition to being a husband and a father, right? There are two things that define me at the end of the day. One is my cousin's drowning, and two is the Holocaust. And I've become much more aware of that while writing the book. I'm far more sensitive to questions of the Holocaust. And when, again, not to beat, what do you beat, a horse or a dog, whatever the hell you beat. When Sean Spicer said what he said, that for me just brought everything to the fore. Maybe in a way that 10 years ago it would not have. And maybe, the older I get, I'm 60 next month, maybe the older I get, I'm more cognizant I am of my parents' experiences. I'm probably more tied up in the Holocaust than I would have been 10 years ago or than I was 20 years ago. And the combination of really, 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 trust me on this one, that Saturday when my cousin drowned and the Holocaust together, I think those two events more than anything led to, and obviously the question my running partner asked me, that's what led to the book. Whether or not that, I'm a classic second generation, there's been tons of study about second generation, there are now studies about third generation, I don't know, but I'm clearly impacted and affected by it.
As a devil's advocate,
yes, ma'am.
In terms of personal complicity, is there a distinction between the drowning incident, where if you called the authority, they would be on your side, and the Holocaust situation, where if you called the authorities, they might support the person who didn't stand up?
First of all, you're right, 100%. I mean, the Hungarian bystander who would have called the Arrow Cross and say, there are two Jews running on street 1, 2, 3, 4, trust me, the Arrow Cross would have been happy to show up and to kill my mother and grandmother. There's no doubt about that. I mean, it wouldn't have thought about it twice. And there's a word I'm going to use that makes me uncomfortable. If you have a better word, I'll adopt it. I use the Holocaust to show the consequences of passivity, non-intervention in a normless society, and then say, today we are a norm-based society. We're a normative society. You today dial 911, and they'll show up within X minutes. So I use the Holocaust and my parents' stories to show what happens when you don't. But I don't have any expectation that 75 years ago, whether the villager in Serbia or the Gentile in Budapest, I don't think they would have called the authorities, because the authorities were as anti-Semitic can be. That's in direct contradiction to today, where we're a normative society, where you are expected to call. I mean, I think you really are obligated to call law enforcement. So I agree with you. Then, no. Today, absolutely yes. That's a very fair question.
Thank you.
Very good.
Today at the City Club, we have been joining a forum with Dr. Amos Guiora, professor in the S.J. Quinney College of Law at the University of Utah and the author of Crime of Complicity, The Bystander and the Holocaust. Today's forum is the Karen Faith Witt and the A.H. Weinstein Memorial Fund on Persecution of the Peoples, made possible by a generous gift from Norman Weinstein and the Friends of Karen Faith Witt. We appreciate their generosity and the support of the City Club. Dr. Guiora appears as part of the City Club's Authors and Conversation series, supported in part by the residents of Cuyahoga County through a public grant from the Cuyahoga Arts and Culture. We appreciate your support. The community partner for today's forum is Facing History and Ourselves. We appreciate your partnership. Lastly, we welcome guests at the table hosted by Facing History New Tech, as well as students from the Flow Homeschool Co-op, Mayfield High School, and St. Martin Porres at today's forum. Student participation in the City Club forums is provided by many foundations, including the William E. Weiss Foundation. We thank you all for being here today. And that brings us to the end of our forum today. Thank you, Dr. Guiora. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. The forum is now adjourned.
For information on upcoming speakers or for podcasts of the City Club, go to cityclub.org.
Production and distribution of City Club forums on IdeaStream are made possible by the generous support of PNC and the Raskin Family Fund, with additional funding from Cleveland State University, Robert Conrad, and the Payne Fund.